friends. So I'll be talking about this topic, nosocomial infections in neurocritical care. So this topic narrative would possibly cover other general intensive care also, but a little more with emphasis on neurocritical care is what I would be talking, because this was a talk I delivered in one of the neuro intensive care conferences. So the topics that I would be covering is a bit of an introduction. And when we talk about infections in neurocritical care, it becomes very important because we understand that the infections tend to be a little more commoner in neuro patients, especially the reason being that they would be obtended. So the risk of infection, as we understand, tends to go up with it is sort of inversely proportional to the GCS. So the lower is the GCS, higher is the risk of infection. So the way I would cover this topic is the respiratory infections in these patients, the risk factor and epidemiology. So I would show the data that we have collected from our own ICU, looking at the pattern of infections that tend to occur, and a brief about diagnosis, prevention, and treatment. So I would cover these topics under these headings. The second more commoner infection that one would see in the neuro ICU or in ICU in general is CRBSI. So central venous catheter related bloodstream infections. Again, in this, I would look at risk factors, epidemiology, diagnosis, prevention, and treatment. And then we would look into catheter associated UTI, risk factors, diagnosis, prevention, and treatment. And since it's neurocritical care, we would talk briefly about external ventricular device infections, EVD infections, and summary. So as we understand, any typical patient in ICU or neuro ICU would typically be connected to a lot of tubes and the monitors, so which automatically puts them at an increased risk of infection. So this is something which we clearly understand. And this risk of infection is twofold. So one thing we need to understand, it may be due to the environmental factors, the bugs present outside, which tends to affect the individual. Or it could be endogenous because of the innate host responses and the colonization that happens in the host due to the impaired defense mechanism, the risk of infection in these hosts tend to increase. And another important aspect which needs to be emphasized is the hand hygiene or the personnel who are taking care of the patient. So when there is no adequate infection control practices that are adopted in these personnel who are looking after, the risk of infection exponentially increases. And it has been looked into time and again that it is always the hands of the personnel who are treating these patients which are directly related to the increased risk of infection. So there has been increased emphasis, which we cannot emphasize more, on importance of hand hygiene. So another important factor that we have recognized is, which we have seen in one of the narrative that I gave on the prevention of nosocomial pneumonia or ventilator associated pneumonia. So we realized that any patient who is in hospital or who is in ICU, who is connected to the tubes, at the end of 48 hours, they tend to get colonized. Aerodigestive tract tends to get colonized with multi-drug resistant organisms if they are in a hospital which has MDR bugs or in an ICU. And these bugs which get colonized in the aerodigestive tract gets aspirated into the airway, eventually leading to nosocomial pneumonias or hospital-acquired pneumonia or ventilator-associated pneumonia. This is something which we have understood. And it has also been recognized that in traumatic brain injury, there is an innate defect in the host immune system. It has been found there is a reduced production of superoxides by the neutrophils, and there has been reduced production of immunoglobulins by the lymphocytes. So this is something that has been recognized in patients with traumatic brain injury. So this is our hospital statistics. So CARI is Columbia Asia Referral Hospital. So I just looked into what is the outcome of the patients. So we've had around 150 neurology admissions, 147 neurosurgery. And if you look at the overall crude mortality, it was 10.6% in neurology. In neurosurgery, we had 8.84%. This is just to draw attention as to what is the risk of mortality in these patients who come to ICU following neuro. So I'll be sharing some of my own unit data to try and corroborate as to what is the gravity of this problem and how we need to address this. So I'm sure this sort of a cartoon or a picture you have seen in a narrative that I gave on prevention of ventilator associated pneumonia. So there are distinctly four risk factors which are very distinctive to the host within the ICU, which makes them to have a higher risk for these nosocomial pneumonia or ventilator associated pneumonia. So obtundation is an important risk factor. So any ICU patient would have central venous catheters or lines. So that puts them at a risk of developing infection. And we saw frequent change in the tubings of the ventilator or re-intubation, duration of mechanical ventilation, malnutrition, and post-surgical status, alcohol, or underlying lung disease or trauma to the lungs following any trauma, polytrauma, that increases the risk of developing the pneumonias. Or any patient who has a end-stage organ dysfunction like liver failure, diabetes, or renal failure, and any patient who is catheterized within ICU. So all this puts them at a tremendous risk of developing secondary infections and supine position. And all the drugs that patient may be on, mainly the antibiotics, corticosteroids, H2 blockers, and sedatives, all these tend to increase the risk of them developing infections. So the listeners can just keep this picture in mind, so which would be easy for you to recall, as to understanding there are 14 risk factors, and one picture tells you the whole story as to what are all the risk factors. So coming to respiratory infections, it has been shown that in neuro patients, the nosocomial pneumonia is the second most common cause of nosocomial infection. And this constitutes around 25% of the ICU infection. And it has been shown that patients who are intubated and who are on a mechanical ventilator for more than 48 hours, 10 to 20% of them tend to develop VAP. And this constitutes around half of the nosocomial infections. And this is an important aspect. So the risk of ventilatory associated pneumonia with every increasing day constitutes about 1 to 3% increase, which means with every passing day, there's 1 to 3% increase in the risk of them possibly developing ventilatory associated pneumonia. And this has a direct bearing on increasing in the cost for the patients. And for the US, it has been attributed to around $10,000 increase in the cost for the patient. And this ventilator-associated pneumonia also doubles the risk of them dying, and it does increase the ICU length of stay. So these are all some of the ramifications or the repercussions of someone developing VAP. So the longer they are on ventilator, the higher is the risk of developing VAP. It will increase the cost to the patient and increase the risk of death and increase the ICU length of stay. So as you know, having a policy or having SOP to prevent ventilatory associated pneumonia is an important quality indicator that needs to be adopted in any ICU. And the quality benchmark is 18 per 1,000 mechanical ventilation days. So this is very important for all the infection control teams which look into how the ICU is performing. And I'm sure most of the listeners in their own units, the infection control teams would be looking into the VAP rates, and it should be less than 18 per 1,000 ventilatory days. If it is more than 18 per 1,000 ventilatory days, which is a benchmark, then obviously you need to improve the SOPs and the systems in place and put in measures to reduce the risk of VAP. So this is something we need to understand. So this is again our data in 104 culture sensitivity positive patients. 76.92 were gram-negative infections and 23.07 were gram-positive infections. So this was compared to the Western data in the early 2000s, which showed predominantly they had gram-positive and gram-negative was 37.6. But this has also changed in the Western world. Even in Western world, now there is an increasing occurrence of gram-negative infections as opposed to gram-positive. And in our data, we found that MRSA load was 20.83% in these patients. And it has been shown that 15% of the Pseudomonas infections are resistant to even carbapenems. So we do have CRAPS, which is carbapenem resistant organisms, or Acinetobacter in India, which is more common. So it has been shown even in early 2000s that 15% of the Pseudomonas were resistant to carbapenems in the US. So the most important aspect of treating any of these infections is to have a local antibiogram to look into what are the type of bugs that are prevailing and what are their sensitivities so that an appropriate initiation of antibiotics can be done for these infections or for these respiratory infections. Because starting a antibiotic which is not appropriate, when we say which is not appropriate, it means it is not covering the bugs that are possibly causing the nosocomial respiratory infections. And this study by Kolev clearly showed, but by initiating inappropriate antibiotic, the risk of mortality was 42% as compared to 17.7%. So we needed to, we embarked upon doing study in our own unit to see how appropriately we are giving antibiotic. So as you see, inappropriate leads to increase in the mortality 3 to 7 fold. So this is our own study in our hospital where we looked at 75 patients. 53 got appropriate antibiotics within 72 hours. The mortality was 11.32%. 22 had got inappropriate antibiotics, and there you see the mortality was clearly very high. Although we did not achieve statistical significance because the numbers we studied was only 75. Possibly increasing the numbers would have led to some significance in this. So what clearly the signals show you is, inappropriate antibiotics anywhere you start does have a bearing on worse outcomes is what we could make out. And this is the breakup of our culture sensitivity. As you see, 60% of the patients had ESBL MDR infections and 40% had MDR infections in our own ICU. So now coming to diagnosis, that's about a risk factor. So what I spoke in last few slides was all the risk factors and the epidemiology within our own ICU compared to the worldwide data that is prevailing. So diagnosis of VAP is terribly, terribly important. So I would see in many places, even today, you find a bug in the DPT, you just start antibiotics. So people do start antibiotics. So it is very important we don't chase the bugs, rather we treat how patient is clinically, we corroborate with the radiology findings and microbiology to make a consensus whether antibiotics should be initiated. So clinical becomes very important. And just so if someone is very clinically stable on a tracheostomy or who was intubated, who's very stable and DPT comes as showing some bug, Pseudomonas, Acinetobacter or Klebsiella, but is perfectly fine clinically, you wouldn't be justified in starting antibiotics unless clinically he manifests with certain symptoms. So what are the symptoms? So if clinically patient has high-grade fever, more than 101, or he's tachycardic, or he has leukocytosis or leukopenia, and he's tachypneic, and his gas exchange is worsening, and he has some thick, yellow, copious, productive sputum. So all these indicate that possibly the patient is developing infection, and no one would really reprimand you for starting antibiotics in these patients who are clinically unwell. But don't start antibiotics just because you found a bug in a DPT or the sputum. And then you would corroborate with the radiology, whether chest X-ray or any imaging you have done shows a new patch or a presence of a consolidation. And then you corroborate with your microbiology. So you basically look into all these three variables in tandem to make a decision of whether the antibiotics have to be initiated. And once you get a DPT culture, there is a quantitative estimation of the DPT culture. So if it is a DPT aspirate, the colony count should be more than 10 to the power of 5 colony forming units. Sensitivity is 70.95 and specificity is less than 50%. If you are doing a bronchoalveolar lavage culture, the colony count should be more than or equal to 10 to the power of 4. For that, sensitivity is 55 and sensitivity is 70 to 100. If you are doing protected brush specimens, then it's the colony count should be more than 10 to the power of 3, and this is the sensitivity and specificity. If you are doing BAL cytology, it should be 2 to 7% cell-associated bacteria. This is the sensitivity and specificity. So generally, many labs would give as 1 plus to 4 plus. So any report you would see with more than 3 plus becomes significant. So this is the quantitative analysis or assessment of how you interpret the cultures. So we spoke about risk factors of respiratory infections. We spoke about epidemiology. Then we spoke about diagnosis and treatment. So treatment, clearly you need to stratify whether the infection that you are dealing is developed within 3 days and patient has come from community. If it has come from community, and these are the common bugs that you would be considering. So the first one is Staphylococcus, H influenza, or Streptococcus. And the choice of antibiotics, if someone has come from community, then it would be beta-lactam antibiotics plus macrolides for atypical cover. But if patient has come to a hospital or he's within the hospital or within the ICU and develops this infection after 3 days, the bugs that you would be typically considering is Pseudomonas or Acinetobacter or Klebsiella. So these are the this is the sort of a morphology of these organisms. And the choice of antibiotic when someone has developed a infection after coming to a hospital or ICU would be obviously any of these fourth generation cephalosporins, so the piperacillin, tazobactam, or carbapenems. And if patient has developed this more than 3 days, if it is showing GPC, MRSA has to be kept in mind. And if you're suspecting MRSA, then the choice of antibiotic would be glycopeptides, teicoplanin, or vancomycin. So this is the sort of an approach that you would have based on the duration and the context of the infections that you are dealing with. So now we'll move to the preventive measures. So we cannot emphasize on how important is hand hygiene is. Hand washing has shown to singularly reduce the VAP rates by 50%, and use of more NIV as a tool rather than jumping and intubating, which we touched about in prevention of nosocomial infection in the previous video. So this goes a long way in reducing the risk of these infections. And simple head end elevation has shown to reduce the risk of aspiration and reduce the VAP rates. And we looked into all these strategies of preventing aspiration by maintaining good cuff pressure in the ET tube and by avoiding unplanned extubation or preventing re-intubation and making good sort of a clinical assessment before extubation and prevention of gastric distension. So all these go a long way in reducing the risk of patient who would develop a pneumonia or nosocomial pneumonia or ventilatory associated pneumonia. And having a good weaning protocol in place to wean them off the ventilator sooner than later and not prolonging the length of ventilation goes a long way in reducing the risk of developing VAP. And it has been increasingly recognized, sanitizing the whole oral cavity and decontaminating with chlorhexidine oral rinse is a simple maneuver which can also eradicate the colonizer and reduce the risk of VAP. So 0.12%, 15 ml, 12th hourly, something that one could consider. So what we also need to recognize is, so any fever in ICU, not necessarily maybe due to infection, and this typically applies in neuro and neurosurgical patients, because someone who is having a big stroke, so the stroke per se by its nature and reperfusion injury can cause a fever, and not necessarily that has to be interpreted as infection. And even traumatic brain injury, they can have a surge response which can manifest as fever. So what simply that means is the signs and symptoms of infections in neuro or neurosurgical patients can be similar to non-infectious causes of fever. And we end up using antibiotics in these patients. So how do we delineate and differentiate that this is not due to infection is by using procalcitonin. So the studies have been done to indicate its usefulness. And this was a very important study which came in Lancet Infectious Disease, Hanjik et al., where they showed if patient is hemodynamically stable, delayed initiation of antibiotics does not worsen the mortality. And rather starting antibiotics after you get the culture report, especially in patients who are hemodynamically stable, has shown to reduce the mortality, increase the appropriateness of usage of antibiotics, and reduces the duration of antibiotics and length of stay. So this is something which has been shown in the study. This is a good study which reemphasizes if someone is stable, you could possibly wait for the cultures and then start antibiotics, and that would carry its own set of benefits and merit. So, and shortening treatment duration also is an important aspect. So it has been shown in community-acquired pneumonia, hospital-acquired infections, or VAP. So the antibiotic after initiating good clinical response is seen within 6 days. You don't necessarily have to give antibiotics for more than 7 days or for more than 10 days in that case, because you would achieve the clinical response within 6 days. And prolonged unnecessary treatment with antibiotics basically lead to emergence of resistant organisms. So do we have studies or justification? This is one of the study which came from the French group, where they looked at 401 patients with ventilatory associated pneumonia, multicentric randomized controlled trial, stratified between 8 days antibiotics and 15 days antibiotics. And they found the clinical outcome was similar between 8 days. So which goes on to show that now the consensus is that we don't necessarily have to give antibiotics for 10 days, six to seven days is good enough. And 10 days or extending beyond that, you should have a very strong reason as to why you may be continuing. Otherwise, 7 days is good enough for most antibiotics. So PCT could be considered, as I said, for discontinuation of antibiotics, especially where you are in doubt that the fever or the manifestations may be due to non-infectious causes. So for that, we have this beautiful study, again by the French group, ProRata trial, which was a big study done in 621 ICU. And they had one group where PCT was used to rationalize and stop antibiotics, and their control group. And they found that the antibiotic-free days was high in the PCT group, which is a good thing, 14.3 versus 11.6. And clinical outcomes were better in the PCT group. Again, re-emphasizing that you can use certain tools like PCT to convince yourself to stop continuing antibiotics where you believe there is no possible underlying infection. So the summary of these nosocomial infections or the pneumonia, which we talk, shortening antibiotic duration is possible and is not detrimental in most critically ill patients, including severe sepsis and septic shock. By shortening the duration of antibiotics, you would do a great justice to the patient by reducing the cost to the patient, reducing the resistant organisms, reducing the emergence of resistant organisms. But exceptions for this is where you may have to continue antibiotics for a longer time, or maybe in combination with immunosuppressed, where they do not grow any, they would not grow any organisms in the culture, or MDR organisms where you have one or two multi-drug or XDR organisms, or where you have initially started on inappropriate antibiotics and now you have escalated to more appropriate. There also you cannot say, okay, I have started antibiotics 3 days back, so I will just give it for 4 more days and finish it. Because the 3 days where you're given inappropriate is as good as not having given anything. So that is about the respiratory infections or nosocomial infections in your ICU. We'll slowly move to intravascular catheter-related bloodstream infections. And as one would agree that any patients who has undergone procedure for neurosurgery or who's having a major stroke or traumatic brain injury, so they would have these invasive lines put in for various reasons. So that has shown to increase morbidity, mortality, and increase in the cost if those catheter-related bloodstream infection happens. And when you look at the world data, it has been shown that the CRBSIs are slowly coming down. 2001 data showed 3.64 by 1,000 catheter days. It has come down to 1.64 by 1,000. But when they took the whole global data, including India, South America, and Turkey, and the Middle Eastern countries, so 2004 to 2009, Victor Rosenthal, so they saw the catheter-related bloodstream infection was 6.8 per 1,000 catheter days, which is much, much more than the US data, what has been depicted. So which goes on to show more emphasis and more stress has to be given in some of these countries to take measures, stringent measures to reduce the risk of CRBSI. So in 2008, they looked at the patients undergoing hemodialysis patients, and they saw that there were 37,000 CRBSIs with staph aureus. So again, goes on to show in dialysis patients who have this dialysis catheter, they are also at an increased risk of developing CRBSI and more so with staphylococcus aureus. So now coming to what is the benchmark? So we saw in a hospital acquired a ventilatory associated pneumonia, the benchmark is you can't have more than 18 per 1,000 catheter days. For CRBSI also, there's a benchmark. It cannot be more than 4 per 1,000 catheter days. So if your unit is reporting more than 4 per 1,000 catheter days of CRBSI, then obviously you need to intensify your SOPs and put in more regimental steps to reduce these rates. So these are some of the landmark studies. So the SCOPE study, which is surveillance and control of pathogens of epidemiological importance. So as you see, this is a very big study of 24,179 bloodstream infections in 49 hospitals from US. And they saw that the bloodstream infections that were present were 51% of the bloodstream infections happened in ICU and 15% happened in children. So which goes on to emphasize that ICU environment becomes a important space where there is increased risk of these patients developing CRBSI. So more efforts have to be put in place in ICUs to see how we can minimize the risk of CRBSI. And CVC was the reason for CRBSI in 72% of the patients. Peripheral lines were the reason in 35%. As you see, the risk of CRBSI with arterial lines is comparatively very less when compared to CVCT, 16%. And the median duration of days from admission for them to develop BSI was 12 to 26, which means to say, again, this is an important point that there is no reason to continue keeping the CVC unless it is absolutely necessary for more days. So if suppose a TBI has come, his acute issues have settled, and when you realize that there is further no need for this CVC, it should be removed and resorted to a peripheral line, because having CVC for a longer time, as you see, the risk tends to continue to increase, and it was highest in 12 to 26 days. And CRBSI has a bearing on mortality, and 27% was the mortality in patients with CRBSI. So this is the biggest data that we have till date to look into the risk of CRBSIs. And what are the risk factors for any patient developing CRBSI? So there are catheter factors. So the skill of an individual who is inserting the CVC, because if he has taken multiple attempts to put the line, and if he has not used strict universal precautions, so then obviously that would render the patient to develop CRBSI. And the duration of having the CVC line in place. So the longer the time the CVC is in, the higher is the risk. And the type of CVC catheter that is put, and the condition under which it has been put. And once the CVC line is inserted, the ongoing care of this catheter also becomes important to reduce the risk of infections. And it is very important to keep inspecting the site and put in a transparent dressing of this nature. So we have clearly understood the entry site of this catheter is something that needs to be inspected, because if there is erythema at that site, that may be an early indication that there is a infection at the catheter site, which can possibly lead to CRBSI. And non-tunneled catheters are at a higher risk of developing CRBSI. So these are some of the catheter factors, and universal precautions have to be mandatorily practiced before any CVC is put in by the operator. And repeated sort of a manipulation of this CVC also can increase the risk of infection. And now the way it is sutured, and there is also a move to not suture the CVC sites, and you have this special sort of a contraptions how to secure the CVP without putting a suture, because when you're putting a suture to secure the CVC, you would have taken a bite through the skin, and that is where there is a possible reason for contamination and further seeding of the organisms leading to CRBSI. So these are some of the catheter related factors which can lead to increased risk of someone developing a CRBSI, and repeated manipulation of a CVC also increases the risk of them developing CRBSI. So with regards to CRBSI, again, to look at the characterization of the organisms. So this was again a good study where they looked at how the risk of MDRs are increasing. So if you see from 1999 to 2007 data, the risk of VREs has increased from 24.7 to 33.3. And the risk of MRS also is slightly increased. But most importantly, what has been increased in CRBSI is the gram negatives. Before, our understanding was CRBSI is typically caused by gram positive. But what we're increasingly seeing is the risk of Pseudomonas has increased from 16.4 to 25. Acinetobacter has really jumped from 11% to 30% as a reason for CRBSI, Enterobacter to 8%. So this is some of the data that has come, which shows that even GNBs are increasingly causing CRBSI, and that is something one needs to bear in mind. And here, this is another big one, which looked into the susceptibility patterns, and they found the susceptibility to quinolones like ciprofloxacin is gradually coming down in this data. So again, our own hospital data of CRBSI. So this is the breakup of organisms. Again, as you see, ESBL MDR organisms sort of dominated. Even in our own study, 57.14% had ESBL MDR infections, which again is frightening that CRBSI infections are no longer only gram positive. It is all gram negative, which is sort of increasing, is what we could make out. So now coming to what are all the steps that one would take to prevent CRBSI. So we cannot emphasize more and more on how important it is to follow universal precautions whilst inserting a CVC catheter, have a gown put in, have a mask put in, have a goggles put in, have a cap put in, have a sterile gloves put in. And the second easiest way is to see as much as possible how you can limit the usage of CVC. And this has really caught on even in our own ICUs, where now after the CVP as a measure for fluid responsiveness has almost become obsolete. So many ICUs, I'm sure, would be now using external jugular veins as a IV access for all any infusions. And CVCs are basically put in very sick patients where a lot of vasopressor infusions is needed. Otherwise, as a norm, I'm sure we have significantly reduced the usage of CVC line unless it is absolutely necessary. This also goes a long way in reducing the risk of CRBSI. As we saw, 76%, nearly 70% of the CRBSIs are caused by CVC lines. And having a good infection control team, which looks or which oversees the usage of safe and effective antibiotics and evaluating and guiding the treatment and having a restrictive prescription where one has to justify himself to continue antibiotics more than 3 doses that gets dispensed and which needs to be justified later on. We call it as a prescription restriction policy, which is controlled by infection control team, can go a long way in reducing the risk of these infections. And educating the staff, educating all the personnel who are dealing with ICU patients who have CVC catheter goes a long way. And having a qualified intensivist or one of the doctors to champion these sort of a preventative measures goes a long way in reducing the risk of CRBSI. And preferential usage of narrow spectrum antibiotics rather than using broad spectrum and continuing. So basically emphasis on de-escalating the antibiotics to the narrowest sort of a spectrum antibiotics, which is effective against the bug that you have isolated, can also go a long way in reducing the risk of these infections. So how do we diagnose CRBSI? So obviously we need to take blood cultures, the number of blood cultures, the volume of blood drawn, and the technique of blood culture also becomes important in yielding the type of organism. So it is shown that the volume of blood that is drawn goes a long way in picking up these bloodstream infections. So as you see, the detection rate is 92% when more than 5 ml of blood is drawn to send for culture, as opposed to less than 5 ml, the detection rate drops to 69%. And it is shown that the yield increases by 3% with every additional ml. So the take home thing is at least you should have more than 5 ml of the blood and preferably 10 ml in each bottle to increase the yield of your blood cultures showing the organism growth. So conclusion, as you see, is minimum is 10 ml. It's preferable for 20 ml in adults. And before drawing blood culture, it is very important to sanitize the skin surface, because very often you would see if this is not done appropriately, your blood culture will grow like coagulase negative staphylococcus or staph epidermidis or staph hemolyticus, which all sort of come from the skin. So the skin surface has to be cleaned with chlorhexidine, preferably. That is now the most accepted. Or if the previously we used to use 70% alcohol with 1 to 2% tincture iodine. So that has almost become obsolete. Now we resort to using chlorhexidine as the preferred choice. And after cleaning it, the skin has to be dried for 1 to 2 minutes. And even after the blood is drawn and being put into this culture bottle, it is imperative that the surface of these culture bottles are clean before the blood is injected into the culture bottle. So these are some of the simple things that one needs to keep in mind. So the treatment, once you have diagnosed, so we spoke about the risk factors for CRBSIs, the epidemiology of CRBSIs, and the diagnosis of CRBSIs. What is the treatment? The first most important is source control. So once you have established that it is catheter related, the first step is to remove the catheter after inserting another line for whatever drugs you are giving. And because CRBSIs develop in the hospital, predominantly the type of bugs you would see is mainly the resistant bugs. So the choices of antibiotics also will be broad spectrum, like carbapenems or fourth generation cefalopyrins, and obviously would give vancomycin because the risk of MRSA also is very high in these patients. And the key element is you start these when someone is sick with CRBSI, and obviously once you got an answer with what bug it is, you would de-escalate to the narrow spectrum antibiotic. So we finished the respiratory infections in neuro ICU, we finished the CRBSI. So we'll talk about urinary tract infection. Again, this is our data from our own hospital. As you see, the ESBL MDR infections constituted 76.19%. And this was on dot same as SMART study, which was a global study, which showed 76% of the UTIs in India was caused by ESBL E. coli. And that we were dot on with our own data showing ESBL MDR constituted 76.19. So with regards to urinary tract infections, it is shown that the duration of Foley's catheter is directly proportional to the rate. Like what we saw, the duration of CVC line is directly proportional to the risk of CRBSI. So the longer you have a Foley's catheter in place, higher is the risk of infection. And again, here they have shown that the risk increases to 3 to 5% per day. So every day you have a Foley's catheter, you are adding 3 to 5% risk. And at the 10th day, so patient is on Foley's for 10 days, there is a 50% risk for these patients to develop UTI. So these are some of the figures that you can keep in mind. Obviously, the prevention, the easiest and common sense prevails, removal of Foley's if a patient can void and can pass urine or changing it to some sort of a condom catheter may help in reducing the risk of catheter-associated UTI. So diagnosis, there is no rocket science. It is sending urine culture. Most importantly, again, like in DPT culture, we need to look at the colony count. If colony count is more than 10 to the power of 5, it becomes significant. So one needs to understand, so you may do a urine routine and you see a lot of pus cells, but patient is perfectly fine. But there is an entity called sterile pyuria, and one needs to understand there are distinctive causes for this sterile pyuria. If someone has already been on antibiotics, if someone is receiving corticosteroids, or if someone has a nephritis, urethritis, prostatitis, cystitis, any of these can cause white blood cells in the urine, and not necessarily that means infection, or someone has a calculi, or someone has a tumor in the kidney. All these are the reasons for sterile pyuria. So when I was doing my medicine post-graduation, this was a very common question we used to get asked. So simply remember, anyone who is on a long-term antibiotics, they can develop white cells in the urine, or someone who is on corticosteroids can develop, or someone who has fungus in the urine or the yeast in the urine can lead to sterile pyuria, or any inflammatory conditions of the kidney, urethritis, cystitis, and urethritis or cystitis or prostatitis, all these can lead to sterile pyuria and nephrolithiasis. So these are some of the causes of sterile pyuria. But it is very important, we need, just because you have seen white cells, we don't jump and give antibiotics. We need to correlate whether there are any other indicators. The simplest one is to look at urine esterase or nitrites, which really indicate there is possibly underlying infection. So why is nitrites in the urine become significant? Because it is shown that nitrates, which are normally present in the urine, are converted to nitrite by this Enterobacter species, and the sensitivity is around 68 to 88%. So this was shown by the Dutch study. And well, like we saw for a ventilatory associated pneumonia, the benchmark was 18 per 1000 ventilated days. For CRBSI, we saw it was 4 per 1000 catheter days. For UTI, it is 6 per 1000 catheter days. So you cannot have catheter associated UTI more than 6 per 1000 catheter days. Obviously, if it is more, then you need to put in more regimental steps. So treatment for UTI, we saw in India, 76% of the UTI is caused by MDR or ESBL organisms as per the SMART study. So again, the choice of antibiotics become carbapenems or aminoglycosides. Duration again would be 7 days unless there is a reason. And this is another important thing which everyone should understand. There is yeast in urine is a very common thing that we see in ICU. And about 3 to 15% of ICU patients can develop yeast in the urine. But we don't need to jump and treat this with antifungals. And Candida albicans is shown to be 46%. And clearly, one needs to reconcile that you don't need to treat yeast in the urine, and treatment is absolutely not needed. The simple thing to do is just remove the catheter or change the catheter. I think that is the simplest thing that you could do. And obviously keep an eye whether there are other sites which are showing this Candida albicans. So if there are multiple sites which are growing, then you can apply that fungal score and then correlate clinically and then have a high index of suspicion of candidemia. Otherwise, just yeast in the urine, we don't jump and treat the infection. Just remove the follies and keep an eye. So now we have finished respiratory infections. We finished CRBSI, we finished urine infection. Now we'll move to the neurospecific ventricular drain infections, or which we call as ventriculitis. So this can lead to the drains, the EVDs, external ventricular drain, which are put to drain CSF or monitor ICP, can lead to ventriculitis and meningitis in 8%. The risk factors for all these infections are the longer you leave the EVD in place, the longer you leave the CVC in place, the longer you leave the patient on an ET tube, you leave the patient on a Foley's, all these exponentially increases the risk of them developing nosocomial infections. So it is shown that the greater the duration, EVD infection is directly proportional to the increase in risk of infection. Or if someone has CSF leaks or other infections anywhere in the body, can lead to these EVD infections also because of whatever breach in the infection control practices that happen. The microbes that typically causes EVD infections are Staph aureus and Staph epidermidis. But in our country, again, if patient has a VAP with GNB or MDR organisms, so or if patient has a CRBSI with MDR, it's very likely the EVDs also can get infected with these MDR organisms. And it is not very conventional in our country to see that EVD infections are caused predominantly by Staph aureus. And how do we diagnose? Obviously, you would see if patient is spiking when the EVD drain is on with a high total count and with the dropping GCS. If GCS worsens in the setting of this fever or leukocytosis with the drain present, so obviously you would suspect EVD infections. The easiest way is to take a CSF from the EVD and send for TCDC and culture and look at the Gram stain to see if there is any infection. So the treatment again, because it is EVD related, so the choice would not be simple antibiotics. It has to be carbapenems or ceftazidime with vancomycin or any of these drugs guided by your antibiogram and your own flora in your ICU. And the key important thing for all this, for ventilatory-associated pneumonia, for catheter-associated UTI, for CRBSI, the most important is try and remove these catheters or external devices. So same thing applies to brain removal of EVD. And there is a concept that if someone is proven to have ventriculitis or EVD-related infection, intrathecal antibiotics are something that can be given. We have even published a paper on intrathecal colistin usage and in MDR organisms, how it has improved the outcome. So intrathecal colistin or intrathecal aminoglycosides or intrathecal vancomycin is all the drugs that you could use intrathecally. And duration for ventriculitis or EVD related infection is much longer, unlike the previous infections where I said the antibiotic is duration is only for 7 days is good enough. But for this antibiotic duration is for much longer, up to 2 to 3 weeks. Is what needs to be incorporated. So I've taken you through the respiratory infections in neuro ICU, CRBSI, which are more common, ventilator associated is common, followed by CRBSI, catheter associated UTI comes third, and then followed by EVD related infections. So the summary is nosocomial infections are common in ICU, and we need to understand when someone has a nosocomial infection in ICU, it increases the length of stay and it worsens their outcome. And the intensivist or the physician in ICU should be aware of what are all the common ICU pathogens that are usually identified in his hospital, in his or her hospital. And he or she needs to be aware of the antibiogram of that hospital to understand what is the sensitivity pattern of these bugs that are prevailing in his ICU or in his hospital. And we cannot emphasize and re-emphasize and re-emphasize on these infection control practices. And having a strong infection control team will go a long way in curtailing the risk of these infections, emphasizing on hand hygiene, emphasizing on isolation of some of these patients with MDR or XDR organisms, following universal precautions whilst doing the procedure, and most importantly, surface cleaning to eliminate all the bugs in the vicinity goes a long way. And for CRBSI, VAP and catheter associated, so as I said, as long as possible, if these external devices can be removed as soon as possible, can go a long way reducing the risk. And caring and inspecting and monitoring these devices to look for any indicators of them developing infection goes a long way. And having a good antibiotic stewardship program has shown to play an important role in reducing the risk of emerging resistant bacteria in your vicinity. And ICU antibiotic rationalization is a two-stage process where no one would argue or be critical about you starting empirical antibodies. But the key essence is after you start empirical antibodies, call up the cultures, and when you are convinced there is no clear indicators of prevailing infection, please stop the antibiotics or de-escalate based on the culture to the narrowest spectrum antibiotics. And de-escalating to monotherapy has to be attempted and achieved by day three to reduce the risk of them developing resistant bugs. So it's a basic talk, but a very important talk. So thank you very much. So end with this beautiful picture. So your index for suspicion for nosocomial infection lies in this subconscious thought process that you should always have this index of suspicion when you're in ICU to pick up these infections very early on to improve the outcomes. So thank you all. You can visit my website, www.drpradeeprangappa.com, to rehear to this lecture to gain clarity and insights. Thank you all.